special districts one way or the other to be the guiding light for a national party that covers a very wide spectrum of belief.
So you don't believe there should be a litmus test on abortion, or is there an issue there should be one on for the Democrats?
I don't think, well, the litmus test should be intelligence, caring about as Harry Truman or Roosevelt used to call it, the common man. We're not going to get everybody on board. And I'm sorry, but running in San Francisco is not like running in Tulare County or Modoc, California, much less Mobile, Alabama. If we want to be a governing party of a very diverse, and I say diverse ideologically as well as ethnically, country, well, then you have to have a broader party that rises above the more particular issues to the generic, the general issue of making America great, if I might take that word.
Going into this 2018 midterms, somebody who's been close to you for a long time, Nancy Pelosi, I believe, was your Maryland state chair back in the day when you ran for president the first time. So you're very close.
That was by the way, that was the high mark of my political career. It's been downhill ever since.
Fair enough. Her image, her unpopularity was among the reasons why some Democrats believe they lost that Georgia special election that was very high profile at the time. She is a very high number. There's some House Democrats that say, you know what, she is too much. She's too much.
Try to replace her with somebody, but to make sure the candidates represent and can empathize and be a part of the district they're running in.
Your term runs out at the end of next year. You don't sound like somebody who's done in politics.
I have a lot to...
start on this one. This is your side of the umbrella here. It was interesting to watch Jerry Brown. He has straddled. Where this fight, and I think you always articulate this very well, is basically the social justice wing of the party versus the economic wing. And while I know you'll make an argument that you can do the two together, there is a split here, isn't there?
I think there has been a split, and it's really driven by consultants. It's really driven by this desire to sort of micro-target an audience rather than give a unified message. And I think the key thing to watch here is the millennial generation and younger, who are going to be 90 million strong in the 2020 election, who more than anyone are looking for, are feeling like they inherited we, I'm like a millennial grandmother here, inherited an economy that is completely broken, a politics that is broken. The people are looking for a populism, but a multiracial populism. They're looking for candidates who say, I'm willing to take on the wealthy and powerful, and also, I'm not willing to let the wealthy and powerful divide us from each other so that they can have the spoils of our great nation. And that is actually, I think, the message that unites identity and class, because we've seen, frankly, the right wing in one breath talk about what's wrong with the economy and scapegoat people of color and immigrants. And I think progressives really need to similarly understand how to weave those messages together.
The or versus the and is what you're having. And it seems like Democrats have struggled with figuring out an and message.
Yeah, I think what you have articulated is the ideal, and I think the real at this point is that the Democrats are still a long way from that. I think Democrats are still trying to figure out exactly who they want to appeal to. Do they appeal to the rising generation? Do they appeal to white working class? They haven't figured out an overall message. I mean, as Governor Brown said, you have rise above certain individual issues to have a larger vision, and I think that's what's been missing in the Democrats.
Well, but the Democrats unveiled, sorry, Andrew, but the Democrats unveiled something, God, it feels like a lifetime ago, it was maybe 10 days ago, that was saying, you know what, we are from, you know, they actually, Schumer was able to get every Democrat in the Senate on an agenda that's a relatively populist economic agenda, this, a better deal, saying we're willing to take on corporations and create a better deal for workers with higher wages, better trade policies, more benefits. That was a huge step forward. I mean, I remember being in Washington and trying to convince the Democratic Party to support big reforms on the affordability of college, and it was, the answer was, we want to tweak interest rates.
Well, it is, but, though, they responded to Trump. This is their response to Trump.
But I think that Governor Brown is really onto something when he says that the Democrats have to be visionary. Mm-hmm. And even in Better Deal, I don't see anything that's visionary. It's actually a throwback to FDR, and it goes so far back. We're not looking forward as a nation, Republican or Democratic parties, to be more visionary, to be more inclusive in a really profound way. He's talking about it as the leader of a very diverse state who has evolved so much since I first covered him in the 80s and 90s when he was first running for president, and had a much narrower view. I mean, he said, you're wrong, Chuck, that there's no difference, but there really is a difference.
He's evolved.
As successful politicians do.
And if I could jump in here, look, as a conservative, I live in Tennessee now, but I've lived in Manhattan, I've lived in Cambridge, Massachusetts, and Center City, Philly, and here's something that progressives really got to work on, and it's one word, an intolerance. At the grassroots of the progressive movement, there is an enormous amount of intolerance for ideological difference. It's not just my 80% friend is my 80% friend. It's my 80% friend is my 1,000% enemy and also a monstrous human being. You see that an awful lot on college campuses, to go back to what we talked about. You see this on the ground in progressive urban centers. There's a huge amount of intolerance, and people around the country see this and reject it. They're repulsed by it.
But one of the things that really strikes me when we talk about college campuses and millennials is the sort of tuning out of politics, elective politics. It gets back to what I think we really need to see in both parties is focusing on legislatures and on governors and thinking and not being afraid of being purged from the roles. And that is a very effective strategy by, you know, the extremes of the right wing right now is trying to claim that there was election fraud and taking this fake commission and making it into a real a fear factor for people who won't tip their toes into elective politics.
I want to pivot here a little bit to, we've been talking about the problems. Let's try to get some solutions. But
There's some structural issues here. As we said at the top of the broadcast, many reasons for the current broken politics. You could say it started with gerrymandering, partisan drawing of districts to help the party doing the redrawing. Then gerrymandering became more precise as technology made it easier to draw the perfect political map. Then legislation designed to guarantee minority representation actually, you could say, accelerated political segregation. I'll get into that in a minute. White districts vote largely for Republicans now and helped the GOP take the House in 94 for the first time in 40 years. And yet, all of those white voters meant they haven't learned how to talk to minority voters. Then you've got McCain-Feingold. Campaign finance law was supposed to take money out of politics. Instead, it prompted Citizens United decision. It simply shifted the money to interest groups, and then political parties lost control of their party, and now the interest groups have more purging power. The point is, Dan Balls, is there isn't one answer. People will say, it's better districts. It's this, it's that. We are in technology has messed this up. There's a entire now structure of our politics that no longer persuades. All of it has led to we do not try to persuade and win an argument. We just try to find people that agree with us in order to win an election.
This is not a solution, but in one way or another, if you eliminated many of the committees like the Democratic and Republican campaign committees from the face of the map, you might begin to get a different dialogue in terms of campaigns. I mean, the industry of politics over the time I've been in Washington, which is a long time now, has, you know, grown and grown and grown. There is a full-time industry
How about the fact that it's an industry?
It's an industry, but it's an industry designed to demonize and destroy the opposition, as opposed to talking about what we were talking about, which is providing a more visionary or more uplifting.
But money is the root of that. I mean, McCain-Feingold is really part of it.
You can't say it's all money, though. I mean, it is a destructive.
But it fuels and the industries are based on.
Yeah, here's what we're spiraling toward, and I'm going to end with this stat here and get you guys. By 2040, this sort of self-segregation that we've done that was sort of started with gerrymandering, in 70% of the country is going to be represented by 30 U.S. senators, and 30% of the country is going to be represented by 70 U.S. senators. If we continue to have a geographic split in this country that goes along party lines, that is a disaster in the making, is it not, David Frank?
Yeah, I mean, I've categorized it this way. It's like we're heading for national divorce. I mean, not anytime soon, but the trends are that we're separating from each other and we don't like each other and we don't watch what each other watches on television. Increasingly, we don't even watch the same sports except for the Super Bowl.
Yeah.
I mean, we're beginning to self-segregate. And then also, we're losing that sense of individual responsibility that says, I'm in primary control of my life.
No, you can blame somebody else.
Yeah, well, yeah, it's the politicians. They're going to help us.
Heather, your response on that?
Well, I mean, you ask about what is a big solution that could potentially, you know, change and fix our broken politics. I do think we have to realize that democracy is a pretty generation has to recommit to, and that fundamentally the system of our democracy is not working. That is, you know, we need deep money in politics reforms, and we need universal automatic voter registration. We need everybody in. And then that point of, are we a demos? I mean, the name of my organization means the people of a nation. Are we a people who feel like we are united by a shared fate? And that has to do with the discourse.
Well, I will end it there. What a great discussion. You guys did your job on discourse on this, so thank you all. That's all we have for today. We'll be back next week, because as you know, if it's Sunday, it's going to be awesome.
Come on and check yourself before you wreck yourself. So take it and check yourself before you wreck yourself.